Hello, welcome to a new lecture of MathS41 Dynamic Optimization. Today, we're going to go into more detail on this Bellman operator and Bellman equation that you have seen in the last lecture. In particular, we're going to show that under some assumptions, it's possible to derive some properties of this Bellman operator. So, to start with, we're going to make a first simplifying assumption. In particular, we're going to assume that the law of motion that we had seen before, so for example xt plus 1 is equal to r of xt at, okay, this was the law of motion, determines the state and x period given the state today and the action today. So we're going to make the simplifying assumption that xt plus 1 is equal to at. So in principle, what you do at period t is you choose immediately the state tomorrow. And in several dynamic optimization problems, you can actually reformulate the model such that the law of motion becomes this. For example, to give one assumption, last time we discussed the AK model, where we had the following Bellman equation, right? So we chose consumption between 0 and AK of U of consumption plus beta V, and then the capital stock tomorrow, which was AK minus C. Okay, so here we have that KT plus 1 was equal to AKT minus CT. Okay, so this was the law of motion, this was our function R, was given by this one. Okay, so in this case, for example, we can set CT, right, by rearranging this equation. We have that this is equal to AKT minus kt plus 1, and then we can use this to substitute into the c's here and the c's here and change our decision variable from ct to kt plus 1. Okay, so if you do this, we have that we can reformulate the model in the following, right? So c now becomes ak minus, so instead of kt plus 1, let me denote k capital stock and x period by k tilde, right, plus bv, now this becomes k tilde, and then now I'm maximizing over the state and next period, and if c goes between 0 and ak, then k tilde varies between ak and 0, so this is a number in 0 ak, okay, and now this becomes our new Bellman equation, so the fixed point of the Bellman equation will be this. Okay, so basically this is now a situation where you're not going to choose an intermediate C, but you're going to immediately choose the state and the next period. Okay, so in general, if you can reformulate a problem like this, then how does it look like? Well, Vx then will be equal to the maximum of the action that you're going to choose A will be in some feasible set of actions. And then we're going to have a value function that depends on the state today and the state tomorrow, right? Plus beta V times the state tomorrow. Okay, so now this is our, let's say, simplified Bellman equation. Okay, and you see that this is in this form where K tilde is now A. This u is now this f, and this v is now this v. Alright, so in some sense, it might be necessary to reformulate this f, right? So this u is not the same as this as a function of k and k tilde, but you can rewrite the problem in this kind of way, okay? So now f is a function from x times x to r and not from x times a, okay? So in this lecture, we're going to start with this Bellman equation, and we're going to show that under some conditions on the primitives f, v, and beta, and so on, we're going to be able to get some desirable conditions on the v. And all the results in this lecture, or the two results, I'm going to look at monotonicity and concavity, and both results are going to be based on the same lemma. So remember that if we have a contraction mapping from some vector space X to some vector space X. And now this X is not the same as this one, right? So this is a general vector space. So T is a contraction mapping. And then if you have a subset B of X, which is closed, and then we have some B tilde, which is a subset of B. And then for every vector X in B, Tx is in B tilde, well, then we know that the fixed point of T, let's say V prime, will be in B tilde. Okay, so if you have a closed subset of our vector space, and then a subset of this closed set, and then for every element in this closed set maps to this subset, then we have that the fixed point is in the subset. Okay, so a special case is where B tilde is equal to B, then we know that fixed point is in B. If you can show that it also maps to a subset, then it's also in the subset. Okay, so this is a lemma that we have proven, I think it was in lecture 2 or 3, probably lecture 3, and this is what we're going to use again today. So we're going to start from a regular problem, and for the definition of regularity, please see the previous lecture. So this imposes some continuity conditions on FG and also on the law of motion, but there's no law of motion in this simplified problem here. Okay, and then it also puts some conditions on how fast F can grow and how fast the phi function can grow. Right, so there should be some phi function also in here, and you assume that this is a regular problem, right? So it satisfies all these continuity conditions, and this allows us telling the intertemporal horizon model with the Bellman equation. Okay, so we have the Bellman operator TV of a state X is equal to the max of A and G of X, fxa plus beta va. Okay, and we're going to assume that f is monotone, and x, which means that if x is greater or equal to x prime, so this can be vector inequalities, right? Then fxa is greater or equal to f x prime a, and if you have a strict inequality, then you have a strict inequality here. Okay, so this is the first assumption, and then you have a second assumption, that is that g, so this is the correspondence here, it's also monotone. So this means that if x is greater or equal to x prime, well then g of x is going to contain g of x prime. Okay, so if for example x is just a number, right, this means that if at some x prime this is g of x, okay, so it's a subset, then if x is bigger, then it will include also all of these points, right, so it will become bigger. So in general our graph g can look something like this, in the sense that the further we go to the right, the bigger these sets become, right? So every set here also includes every set that comes before. Okay, so we're going to assume monotonicity of F, and we're going to assume monotonicity of G. So this is a weak inequality and strict inequality, so often this is called strictly monotonicity of the function. Right, so this is monotonicity of a function, this is monotonicity of correspondence. Well, we can show that if these two conditions are satisfied, then the fixed point of T, which is a Bellman operator, right, let's say that this is V prime, is also strictly monotone. Okay, and particular, if x is greater or equal to x prime, then v star of x will be greater or equal to v star of x prime, and if you have strict inequality, then you have a strict inequality. Okay, so this is what we're going to demonstrate now, and we're going to use this this lemma. So remember that T maps all continuous functions on X bounded in the fine norm to the set of all bounded continuous functions on X bounded in the fine norm. Okay. So for this lemma, this C phi of X is now this vector space X. Okay, it's a different X. Okay, and so we need to find a closed set that maps to some desirable subset B tilde of subset of this here. And we're going to put B tilde the set of all functions that satisfy the property that we want to demonstrate, right? So this one. So B tilde consists of all functions V in C phi of X, right? So it's a subset of the vector space, such that for all X, X prime and X, if X is greater or equal to X prime, then Vx is greater or equal to Vx prime. And strict inequality, then this is a strict inequality. Okay. And for the lemma, we also needed a set B, right, which was closed. And now for this result, we're going to take B to be the set C phi of X itself. Okay, so this is a closed set because every convergent sequence in the set converges to an element of the set. Okay. So what do we need to do? We need to show that if V is in our vector space, then TV is in B tilde. Okay, so in particular, we need to show that for all X, X prime and X, if X is greater or equal to X prime, then TV of X is greater or equal to TV of X prime. And if you have strict inequality, then you have strict inequality here. Okay. So take X greater or equal to X prime. And then you can see what is exactly TV of X prime. Well, it's by definition, it's the maximum of A and G X prime of F X prime A plus B to V A. Okay, so this right hand side can be solved, right? So for example, let A star in G of X solve this problem. Okay, so if A star solves this problem, well then we know that this maximum is equal to F X prime A star plus beta V V star. Okay. Now if A is in G of X prime and G is monotone and X prime is smaller or equal to X, well then we know that G of X prime is a subset of G of X. Okay. So in particular, this means that A star is also in G of X. So A star is a feasible problem for G of X. Okay, so what are we going to do? We're going to basically shift from this X prime and A star to the problem in X, because this is going to give us this value here. Okay, so first thing that we can do is we can use the fact that F is monotone, right, and X prime is smaller or equal to X. So this is less or equal to F of X A star plus beta V A star. Okay, now we can use the fact that A star is in G of X, right? So this is a feasible value at X. So a feasible value is less or equal to the maximum that I can attain in G of X. Okay, so A prime is in G of X. So here I'm taking the maximum over all G of X. So this is why I get less than or equal sign. So this is fxA plus beta V A. And then by definition, this is nothing else than TV of X. Okay, so I have shown that if X is greater or equal to X prime, then TV of X is greater or equal to TV of X prime. So the first condition here is satisfied. So what happens if I have a strict inequality here? Well, then derivation remains the same, except that now here I have a strict inequality because f is strictly monotone. So tv of x is strictly bigger than tv of x prime. So I also have to show in the second condition. Right, so this shows that indeed the fixed point of this Bellman equation is going to be in the set B tilde, which is a set of strictly monotone functions. So for our second result, we will do a similar thing in order to exercise a bit more. But now we're going to look at the notion of concavity. Okay. So as before, let x, f, g, beta be regular. So a regular problem. And we're going to use concavity, so we're going to impose some concavity restrictions on f and g. So in particular, we're going to assume that f is a concave function. So this means that for all x, x prime, a and a prime, and x, and for all alpha between 0 and 1, well, alpha fx a plus 1 minus alpha f x prime a prime. Okay, this is going to a concave function. All right, so this is going to be less or equal to f alpha x plus 1 minus alpha x prime alpha a plus 1 minus alpha a prime. Okay, so this is concavity of f. Strict concavity, right? We're going to impose strictly concavity. This means that for all x, x prime, a prime, such that x, a is different from x prime, a prime, and for all alpha strictly between 0 and 1, we also have the strict inequality here. Okay. So we're going to impose this condition on f, and then we're going to assume or impose a concavity, not concavity, but convexity condition on g in the following sense. We're going to assume that if a is in g of x and a prime is in g of x prime and alpha is between 0 and 1, then alpha a plus 1 minus alpha a prime is in g of alpha x plus 1 minus alpha of x prime. Okay, so this notion is not the same as saying that g is convex valued, right? In particular, it's a much, much stronger notion than convex valuedness. Because if, for example, I have here an x and here an x prime, and for example, here I have an a in g of x, right? So g of x could be something like this, and here I have an a prime. Well, this means that this entire line segment should also be in the correspondence. Okay, so the graph of the correspondence should look like a convex set, right? So basically, this is what it means. This arched region here should be convex. Okay, so we're going to assume strict concavity of f and convexity of g, and then this is going to show that the fixed point v star of t is strictly convex in the following sense: for all x, x prime and x, and for all alpha between 0 and 1, alpha vx plus 1 minus alpha v x prime is less or equal to v alpha x plus 1 minus alpha x prime. And if x is also distinct from x prime and alpha is strictly between 0 and 1, then I have a strict inequality. Okay, so that's strict concavity, sorry, strictly concave. Okay, good. So how are we going to do this? Well, we're going to use the same lemma. And now we're going to use two different sets, B and B tilde. So the set B is, so remember, T contraction mapping of the Bellman operator is going from C phi x to C phi of x. And I'm going to use the set B of all functions such that V is concave. Okay, and B tilde is going to be the set of all V and C phi of x such that V is strictly concave. Okay, so in order for the lemma to work, I need to show one that B is closed, and two, I need to show that for all V in the set, TV is in B tilde. Okay, so let's first show the first condition. So I want to show that B is closed. So if I take a sequence Vn in B, well, then these are all concave functions. Okay, and let me take the limit Vn to V. What I need to show is that V is also in B, so V is also a concave function. Okay, so take an x and an x prime in x and take an alpha in 0, 1. Well, because all the Vn's are concave, I know that alpha Vn x plus 1 minus alpha Vn x prime is less or equal to V alpha x plus 1 minus alpha x prime. Okay, so that's concavity. And now, so here, this limit here, remember we're using vector space with the phi norm. So this is convergent in the phi norm, right? So this means that Vn minus V in the phi norm, this distance here between these two functions converges to zero. And convergence in the phi norm also implies pointwise convergence. So if I take the limit for n going to infinity, this here converges to alpha Vx plus 1 minus alpha Vx prime. There should be a V in here, sorry. And this here converges to V of alpha x plus 1 minus alpha x prime. Okay, and the limit inequalities are preserved. So here this shows that indeed V is also concave, because this was for any x, x prime and any alpha. Okay. So this shows indeed that B is closed. Notice, however, that B tilde is not closed, right? Because for B tilde, sometimes you have here a strict inequality, which is not necessarily preserved in limits. Okay, but concavity is a property that's closed by taking limits. Okay, so B is closed. Well, take a V and B. We need to show that TV is in B tilde. Okay, so take x tilde and x, and take an alpha between 0, 1. Okay, so what's TV of x? Well, this is equal to the maximum of a and g of x of f xa plus beta v a. Okay, and TV of x tilde is the same thing, but now for x tilde. Okay, so in principle, we can solve this problem and this problem. Okay, so let A star solve this problem, and maybe let A star tilde solves this problem. Okay, so, and now let me define, for ease of notation, let me define x alpha to be equal to alpha x plus 1 minus alpha x prime, and let me take a star alpha to be equal to alpha a star plus 1 minus alpha a star prime. Okay, so I'm just taking the convex combination of this x and this x prime, and the convex combination of this a star and this a star prime. Okay, and notice, because this is in g of x and this is in g of x prime, then because this is a convex combination, this is in g of alpha x plus 1 minus alpha x prime, and by definition this is equal to g of x alpha. Okay, so remember what we wanted to show. We want to show that tv is in b tilde. All right, so let me take alpha tvx plus 1 minus alpha tvx prime. So I know that tvx is equal to this, and a star solves this problem. So I can plug an a star into this objective function, and this would be equal to tv of x. Okay, so this is alpha fx a star plus beta v a star plus 1 minus alpha, and now the same here for x tilde, fx tilde a star tilde plus beta v a star tilde. Okay, now working out the brackets, I have alpha f x a star plus 1 minus alpha fx prime a star prime plus beta, and then alpha v a star plus 1 minus alpha v a star prime. Okay, so I know that f is concave. Okay, so I know that this is less or equal to fx alpha a star alpha. Okay, because x alpha is a convex combination, a star alpha is this convex combination, f is concave, so I have this inequality. Then beta, and now I'm looking at this here, and I know that v by assumption v was in b, right, and b is the set of concave functions, so I know that this is less or equal to v a star alpha. Okay, we're almost there. So a star alpha is in g of x alpha, but it might not be the optimal one, but at least it's feasible. Okay, so this I know is less or equal to maximum of a in g x alpha of f x alpha a plus beta v a. Okay, so this one is feasible, it's in the set, but it might not be the optimal one. So if I take the optimal one, I get a value that's greater or equal to this one here, and now I have that this is tv of a of x alpha. Okay, so alpha tv of x plus 1 minus alpha tv of x prime is less or equal to tv of x alpha, so this shows that tv is concave. All right, for strict concavity I can do something very similar. So let x x prime be an x, and assume that x is different from x prime. And now we take alpha with strictly between 0 and 1. So this here is all the same, nothing there. And then in the derivation, if I go from this step to this step, then by strict concavity of f, this here becomes a strict inequality. Okay, so for the f part. not for the second part, but that's enough to have a strict inequality here. So I have that TV of x alpha is strictly bigger than alpha TV x plus 1 minus alpha TV x prime. Okay, so TV is in fact strictly concave, which means that TV is in B tilde, which is what I wanted to show. Okay, now we're going to use previous results to show another theorem. Okay, so as before, we're going to start from a regular problem. Right, and we're going to assume additionally that F is strictly concave. And we're going to assume that G is convex. And convex in the sense that we have seen in the previous theorem. Okay, so we're going to look at the Bellman operator. TV of X is equal to the max of A and G of X of fxa plus beta va. So now assume that, for example, v is strictly concave. Well, if v is strictly concave, right, then this here is also strictly concave in A in particular. Right, because f is strictly concave, v is strictly concave, so the sum of two strictly concave functions is strictly concave. So we're maximizing over a compact domain, let's say, a strictly concave function. So what do we know here? Well, we know by lecture 4 on the optimization problem, that there's a unique solution to this problem. Okay, and in particular, this unique solution will generate a solution function, solution correspondence, but this one will be single valued. So we have a solution function, and we can call this gamma x. Okay, so gamma x is equal to the arg max of a n g of x fxa plus beta VA. Okay, so this is what we're after. And we're going to look at this Bellman operator in an iterative sense, right? So we're going to start with the function V. We're going to generate new and new functions. Each time we will generate a policy function, a solution function here. And then we're trying to see what happens to this function in the limit. Okay, so let me take this clear. So let V0 be concave, right? So we start with a concave function. It can, for example, be the constant function, which is always concave. Okay, and we're going to generate iteratively Vn plus 1 of x is to be equal to the max of a and g of x of f xa plus beta vn of a. Okay, so we're going to do this over and over again, and we know that this maps concave functions to strictly concave functions by the previous theorem, right? So after one iteration, we have a strictly concave function, we plug the strictly concave function back in, and so on and so on and so on. All right, so after one step, you already have a strictly concave function here, so we can use the unique solution. Okay, so now let me define gamma n of x to be equal to arg max a n g of fxa plus beta vn of a. Okay, here I'm taking n greater or equal to 1, right, in order to be sure that this here is strictly concave. Okay, v0 is concave, so v1 is strictly concave. By the previous theorem, right, after every iteration you arrive at the strictly concave function, so this is strictly concave, so I have indeed a correspondence here. So now the question is this converging, right, because I know that these v's here, so this v ends converge in the phi norm to some fixed point v. Okay, so in particular vn minus v in the phi norm converges to zero. This is the same thing. And of course, v will be strictly concave. Right, this is by assumption. So we can look at the limiting, can look at the solution correspondence for this limiting problem. So this is arg max a n g x of f x a plus beta v a. Right, and now here we have the limiting function. This is a strictly concave problem. This is strictly concave, this is strictly concave, right? So we have unique solution, which we call gamma of x. Okay, so now the question is, what's the relationship between this here and this here? Okay, so the theorem says the following. The theorem says that for all x and x, gamma n of x converges pointwise to gamma of x, right, at every x. And if x is compact, then gamma n minus gamma even converges in the phi norm. Okay, so this is pointwise convergence, this is even stronger convergence. And for this we're going to use a result that you have seen a few lectures ago, where we had this kind of setup. Alright, so let me write down the setup. We had functions fn, right? So we're maximizing a and g of x of n fn x a. Okay, this was strictly concave and continuous, and we so this had a unique solution, and we call this gamma of x, gamma n of x, if I remember well. And we had that these fn's in some sense converges to some function f. Okay, I will immediately write down on the right in what sense this convergence was there. So we had a limiting problem, arg max a and g of f x a is in gamma of x, and we were looking at the notion of how this converges to this in the limit. Okay, and the assumption that we imposed on how this fn converges to this f was the following. We had that the supremum of x in x and a in gx of fn xa minus f xa divided by phi of x, that this had converged to zero. And then we had the following result. First, that for all x, gamma n of x converged to gamma of x. Okay. And then pointwise, and then if x is compact, then you had that gamma n minus gamma in the phi norm converge to zero. Okay, so basically here we have an identical situation, right, where the fn's, these functions, are equal to these functions. Okay, and our f, our limiting f here, is equal to this function here. All right, so let me write this down. I have fn x of a is equal to f x of a plus beta vn of a. And then my limiting function f x of a was equal to f x of a plus beta v of a. Okay, so in order to show that these two conclusions hold, which are exactly the same as these two conditions, okay, because these are the arg maxes of this optimization problem, the only thing I need to show is that this is indeed satisfied. Okay, so I need to show that the sub of fn xa minus fxa divided by phi of x converges to zero. And this is what I'm going to do now. Okay, so let me take fn xa minus f xa absolute value. Okay, and then I'm going to take this up in a second. Okay, and here a is in g of x. So plug this in here, right? I get fxa plus beta vn a minus f xa minus beta v a. Well, the f's drop out, okay, so this is equal to the absolute value of v, and then vn a minus v a. Okay, so beta is a strictly positive number, so this is equal to b beta. I want this to converge to zero, all right? So this is at one particular value of a. So let me write this towards using the phi norm. Okay, so divide by phi a and multiply by phi a. Okay, then this is less or equal to beta times phi a, and then the phi norm of vn minus v. Okay, I know that this converges to zero. Okay, why? Because of the contraction mapping theorem. Okay, now I have this beta phi a, and I know that this is less or equal to beta times the maximum of a and g of x of phi a. And remember here that a was equal to r xa, right? So a was the next state in the problem. Okay, so this vn minus v in the phi norm. And then because this is a regular problem, I know that this here is less or equal to theta times phi of x. Okay, look it up in the previous lecture. If this is a regular problem, then you have this inequality. So we're stuck with vn minus v in the phi norm. And now I can take phi to the other side. Okay, so basically what I end up with is that fn xa minus f xa for a in g of x divided by phi x is less or equal to vn minus v in the phi norm. So the right hand side is just a number, right? It doesn't depend on a, it doesn't depend on x. Okay, it's just a number, and this holds for any x and every a and g of x that I can think of, so it also holds for the supremum over all x and x. Okay, so this value is less or equal to this, and I know, right, because t is a contraction mapping, I know that this converges to zero, which indeed shows that this property holds. Okay, and this concludes the proof. So what does this mean? It means that if the conditions of the theorem are satisfied, right, we have a regular problem where f is strictly concave and g is convex, and what I can do, I can start from a concave function. Okay, I can iterate the problem over and over again. At every instance, I can compute the policy function that results from the maximization at the nth iteration, right? Then I know that pointwise, this policy function will converge to the policy function of the Bellman equation, the fixed point one, okay? And we know that this here, this policy function basically tells you what to do in the next period. If x is a state today, it tells you what to do to date in terms of optimal action, okay? So this says that if I iterate this procedure over and over again, I will get arbitrarily close to the policy function of the fixed point of the Bellman equation. And if x is compact, then actually I have convergence in the uniform convergence in the phi norm. Okay, so this basically tells you that iterating the Bellman equation over and over again will not only lead me to converge in terms of the value function, the v function, but it also allows me to converge in terms of the policy function, which tells me the best thing to do for a given state. Thank you for watching.